tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Oh. Hey guys, I'm your host Jade Howard with AfterBuzz TV, and we just finished watching Stalker, Love is a Battlefield, and to my left I have my host.
Hey, Cameron Lewis here, and also...
Hi everyone, it's Anastasia Waller.
Hi everyone, it's Teresa Ma.
And we have a special guest with us today. We have Mariana Claveno. Thank you so much for joining us.
Claveno.
Claveno.
I know. God. It's okay. It's a tough one.
It's tough.
Claveno.
I have Howard, so it's like no one ever messes that up.
Mariana, who plays Janice on the show.
So thank you again.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So,
first impression.
Another one. So there weren't as many jumpy moments this week, but it was the jumpy moment that got me the best, I think, which was in the parking garage. And we'll get to that in a second. But it was a good episode. It was a good episode. Found out a little bit more about Jack in this one. Saw a little bit more of Janice in this episode, which was great.
Mm-hmm. Janice got to get in there.
Yes.
Yeah. Did more detective work instead of just stuck behind her desk.
Yeah.
Right. Waiting for everyone to bring the cases to her to give her analysis on people.
Give her expert analysis.
Exactly. Anastasia?
I thought it was a great episode. I agree with Cameron. It wasn't as jumpy as last week for the Halloween episode, so it was a little more toned down, but I feel like we kind of got back into the groove of Stalker and the cases in LA, so liked it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I really enjoyed it. It kept me guessing the whole time. Mm-hmm. I wasn't ever really sure who it could be, and I'm still getting over like the fact that Roxy the dog died.
I know.
Who kills her own dog?
I'll have to say, from my first impressions, it just definitely reinforces why I cannot watch this show by myself. Because that one scene where we all screamed at the same time. The parking lot scene, like, we knew something was going to go down. We knew it.
Mm-hmm. And it still scared us. If you have a surround sound system or headphones when you're watching the show, not a good thing.
Right. Or alone in the dark.
Did you watch this alone in the
dark? Yes, I did. I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning, don't ask, and I watched it, and it was still dark, and I was freaking out. I wasn't thinking straight when
I'm with you, Teresa, though. I kept going back and forth between everybody. At first, it was like, okay, it's Kenneth. Well, they introduced him kind of early. Maybe it's not Kenneth. Okay,
it's Kenneth. Kenneth was too obvious of a choice.
I thought that, and then, this is the first episode where I didn't suspect somebody completely innocent. Which was, that was new for me.
I did that this episode. I suspected the housekeeper that she had with her, or her assistant, Roxy.
Okay, right.
I was like, it's her.
Robin.
What about for you, Mariana? Like, I know this was your first time seeing the episode, so what were your impressions?
Yeah, it's always different seeing it, because it's, I always feel like I need to watch the episode again, because my first impression is sort of really dissecting my own performance and remembering what it was like to film it. And oh, that was the day that happened. Or, oh, that's when we had, you know, tacos for lunch. So it's kind of, it's hard for me sometimes, like, completely just watch it as an audience member does. Mm-hmm. But I liked it. I thought it was fun. I mean, I thought that it moved pretty well. I thought that, I thought the twists and turns were good. I remember reading on the page, and I thought, I don't know. I think this is going to be obvious. I think we were worried about that, actually, as we were shooting it. Yeah, that she was going to seem too obvious. But it didn't. I don't think it came off that way. And clearly, you guys didn't know.
No, we didn't. You let us keep going with our predictions.
Yeah. I'm not gonna spoil that.
You're just like, you'll see.
Did
like,
you guys ever think it was Amanda at any point?
No,
I didn't.
Amanda.
Or not Amanda,
Melissa.
Andrea.
I was like, Amanda.
I was with you. I was
really
with you.
Weird.
I know.
Andrea.
Andrea.
I did. I kind of did whenever they reveal it. more or less. I would definitely did not think that she had any involvement whenever they show the dog, because she seemed so upset by it, and she found the dog in a box, and she was visibly right. shaken. Good performance.
Or the attacking, when she was attacked, I didn't think she was in on it. Because she got beat pretty hard, and she's older. She's a little bit fragile, so I definitely didn't suspect her from that.
We kind of wrote her off when we saw those
things.
Definitely, definitely did. So let's go into the first topic of talking about Andrea's case.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She's very well, was divorced. She got, 95% from the prenup. So make note to self, get married and get your prenup done in California. If you live in Arkansas, say you're having a destination wedding and go to the California courthouse.
Well, she had in her prenup that if...
Oh, thank you. The more you know. Very nice. Even in the
booth. I love that.
She had in her prenup that if he cheated, she would get 95%.
Yeah, that's not California law.
Oh, that's just... No. Okay, so if you get a prenup, if your man says... No, hold on, Cam. If your man says, honey, we need to get a prenup, I'll say, that's perfectly fine, because there's things we can put in this thing.
That works to my advantage.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And they thought prenups were bad.
So who would cheat? Why would he cheat if he knew that? That's crazy.
He's bold.
Worth the risk, apparently, in his book.
Well, according to Jack.
Melissa, she's kind of a crazy person.
You left your wife for that girl. She was not mentally stable at all.
He has a type.
He has a type.
Mentally unstable women.
Yes, he does. You're right. Cue the music again. We need that.
First thing we see in this case is the dinner scene at the party at the beginning of the episode. Mm-hmm. Lights are flickering.
Right. A little weird.
Run.
Well, no, it's normal in California. Everybody, there's always like a power outage, like at least every 6 to 7 months.
I'm just saying, if I'm Thanksgiving's coming up. If the lights start flickering at the Thanksgiving feast,
you're freaking out at the table.
I'm gone. It was scary. It was a good thing. And then you see the words written all over the house.
I was going to say that was another reason that I didn't suspect, that I did not suspect Andrea.
Right. It takes a lot to stage
Stage that and write all of that and glow in the dark paint on the wall. So I never really was let on to her.
Like, and there were nice things. Like, I couldn't think, I'm going to write all these horrible messages about myself in my house.
Yeah.
Front of guests.
Yes, your friends, your social circle.
Yeah. She's committed.
Yeah, she was committed.
She apparently hired, Damon.
Damon, the artist.
To do that in her house. So that's commitment there. That's commitment.
And she had 95% of the net worth. That was the biggest thing that kind of threw everyone off. If you get 95%, why are you stuck on revenge and stalking?
Worth it.
Right.
It was a nice house. It's not like she got left with like a 2-bedroom bungalow in the middle of like bad part of East Los Angeles. I mean, she was in the hills. Mm-hmm. She had a great view, and they were sitting on the couch. And you see that panoramic view in the background?
That house was gorgeous.
It was gorgeous, right? I'm sorry. I'm cool. I'm going to just chill in my house. Might be a little angry. Go get some therapy. You got 95% of his net worth.
I think she was just so consumed by revenge stalking him. And I think at one point at the end of the episode, she says there's nothing worse than a divorced woman with too much time and money on her hands.
Apparently not.
Yeah. That was a good quote.
That was a really good one. That summed it up. That summed up her motive.
Yeah. I can think of better things.
I could too.
Yeah.
When you were filming in that house, were you just thinking like, okay, I just want to live here for the rest of my life?
Yeah. I mean, it was so hot though. Remembering, oh my God, it was so hot. I don't exactly remember. I think it was August when we shot that episode. Was it September? It was September, and we had like that heat wave.
Yes,
that was bad.
Yeah, and it was so hot, but it was gorgeous. We were all, I think, casting votes and betting on how much it cost that house.
Did you guys find out?
It was in kind of Sherman Oaksy, but like up at the top of the hill.
Oh, okay. Did you guys find anyone win the bet?
I think I left before that for that information.
Okay,
so she's got these crazy words. There's clearly we're under the impression that she has a stalker, and she thinks it's her ex-husband, and so they go to investigate him. And they see that he's with the woman that he had cheated on her with. Her name was
the young adult.
Melissa.
Very young adult.
She's a very young adult.
Compared to him.
Yeah. It's almost like you could see almost maybe a little bit of regret, maybe him thinking, yeah, I left my wife. I could have just cheated, continued. Like, if I didn't get caught,
yes,
I could have like kept this going. But I think he kind of felt a little
and
stuck
I thought
with
that
her.
Was also very LA that she was, you could tell she was younger. She was like a sugar baby.
Yeah.
She was. I was like, that's so LA.
But that was
for the young chick.
For her, it was like a sugar daddy plan gone completely sour.
Yeah.
Because she's thinking, like, I've got this guy with all this money, but then his wife took him to the cleaners.
Yeah.
They look like they still lived in a nice house, but I mean, compared to what we saw the wife living in.
Yeah.
I thought that it was weird when we were introduced to her, because I initially thought, okay, Kenneth, but then, like Teresa said, it's too obvious that early on that it would be Kenneth, and then I thought, okay, maybe it's Melissa, but then I was like, she seems too crazy, visibly, outwardly, to
right.
be the person stalking
Andrea.
He
made a really convincing case when Maggie's character came in and kind of interrogated him. He was like, no, I'm done with her. I just want to be over it.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so Melissa, they investigate because she ends up, she's at home. I'm sorry, her name is Amanda. And she's at home, and she's with her assistant, and she's, like, getting ready for, like, a fundraiser event. And she's got this box. Okay.
Andrea?
Andrea. Okay. Uh-huh. I don't want to call her Amanda. So, Andrea. Okay. So, she has this box sitting on the, you're my assistant. I have a stalker. Now, I have this strange package. We don't know who it's from. You need to check for me. Prep me to know that what I'm going to open is my dead dog. So mm-hmm.
I just wouldn't let the person open it, you know?
Right. I'm like, you know, yeah. right.
You don't want to see this.
If you open this box, you're going to see Roxy. And Roxy, we saw, and we all thought Roxy was just adorable. Oh, and then we see Roxy in the worst state that you ever want to see a cute dog in, which is a dead state. And they start to think that maybe it's Melissa because there was this Bible scripture. And they said, okay, well, her father is a pastor, so maybe that's, there's a connection. Oh, and guess what? She also was held for 72 hours, and she's 5150, so she's not all there. Mm-hmm. So they're thinking that maybe it's her, and she couldn't handle that questioning. Like, she looked like she was about to go back to the bin.
She was going crazy.
She was going crazy.
She was like, I know my rights.
Yeah. I was like, oh, she's not. If it's not her, she's going to lose her mind. Poor thing.
I thought something was going to go down there.
And so they end up, so then we cut to, we're in the parking lot now.
Mm-hmm.
And we're thinking, why is she in the parking lot alone? And we're all thinking, this is not going to be end well. And then she gets attacked, and we all scream like maniacs because even when you can predict what's going to happen in something like that, it still scares you because you kind of want to be a little wrong. I felt like I wanted to be wrong in thinking that, like, oh, false alarm, but no.
This show is doing real bad things for my, like, wanting to park anywhere.
Especially living in
LA.
Yes.
I don't feel safe in somebody's Hollywood Hills home.
But we're learning a lot of tips,
to Roxy.
So we can be on the lookout.
It's true.
This is true.
It's very true. Don't trust the clown that walks into your bathroom.
Never trust the clown in the bathroom.
No.
I was walking in a parking garage today, and I literally looked, and I was the only one there in the parking lot, in the structure, and I thought to myself, oh, great. I'm in a scene of stalker.
legitimate, though.
It was.
It's a legitimate fear,
but I was walking, like, super cautious, so if anybody saw me walking down, I'm, like, looking like, like I'm prepared to attack, just in case. Yeah.
Oh, man. So, Andrea, we find out she paid to be attacked in the parking lot.
By her lover, artist, who also painted all those derogatory words, Damon, on her house. And so it's, that's just weird.
Yeah.
Attack me? That's taking it far.
Paying somebody to write bitch above your mantelpiece, like their mantelpiece, that's definitely a commitment, but like having somebody attack you, that's.
I mean, how are you going to get that paint off? Was I the only one that was worried about that? You gotta take the paint down. You gotta take the paint off. Like afterwards, like who's going to clean that up?
That's true. It's a valid point.
Thank you. Thanks, Cam.
You're welcome. He's going to throw the box away.
And Damon, how did he not feel bad doing that? punching in a little baby.
Well, you got paid very well.
I know, but still.
Yeah, when do you start asking questions? Like, all right, Damon, I know we've been, like, sleeping together, but I want you to kind of meet me in the parking lot tonight. Or you want to go on a date? No. I want you to beat the shit out of me.
Yeah. Beat me up.
Yeah.
Beat me to a pulp. What? I'm sorry. Wait, but he didn't even get, like, a real Rolex.
You got a fake one.
It was a fake one.
You got a fake one. But, you know, he's an artist. He needs the money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That is true.
You know.
Starving artist.
Yeah. Struggling artist. L.A.
/ male somewhat of a prostitute.
Yeah. 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 I got that vibe.
Masseuse.
He had a website.
Oh, I wrote it down. Where's it
Another
at?
Another website.
Oh, man.
It was like massage.
DamonMassage.com.
There's always a good website.
Yes, we were going to say that's one reoccurring theme on the show. It's a website. We're like, oh, there's another website.
I found this website.
Yeah. The websites and the names in this show.
The names.
At least early on, the names were like Buford is one of our favorites.
Yes, that was our favorite. We couldn't stop talking about that for like two recap episodes.
That was from the pilot. That's the pilot episode. Yeah.
We're like, Buford.
The Whitley family was also from the pilot.
Perry Whitley of the Whitleys.
Yeah.
We say that as a joke. You mean Perry Whitley of the Whitleys?
So good. And then what do we see? We see Andrea in the hospital. They do some talking to her. And then we go cut to the police station. We have surveillance video now. And this is where they see the connection with the watch.
Mm-hmm.
So we bring back to Kenneth. We're back at Kenneth. And I thought at that point, okay, it's Kenneth. There's maybe somebody in it on it with him, Melissa, probably. She's a crazy person.
I thought it was Melissa.
I ruled Melissa out because I said in the room that that run was way too husky. It looked like a football player run.
But
so I knew it wasn't a girl.
In our defense, though, you've had bad stunt doubles before, right? So we couldn't completely rule it out because you said that you've had someone you're like, hey.
Yeah, your normal girl or whoever is on another job and they got to call in somebody. I should not disparage the good name of our, stunt workers out there, but yeah, I've had a few that were like...
Sometimes they got to call in Buford
Buford.
And the reason why we thought that Melissa may have had something to do with it is because Melissa, we see crying, like boohooing in the house. She was crying really loud, too. I mean, I guess I would, too, if I saw that my man was cheating on me. With his ex-wife, that he left her. You left her to be with me, and you're sleeping with her again? Like, this can't be right.
And there's a dead dog, and there's blood everywhere.
Roxy!
Very confusing situation.
Oh, Roxy.
Poor Roxy.
I know.
Did you get to meet Roxy on set?
I did. Oh. There was actually a scene where they cut it, because it never really worked out right, where I leaned down and pet the dog. Right before the booby line, talking about that.
Oh yes,
but it looked too staged. Like we just couldn't do it with the dog trainers and the dog. Like it just looked too like and cue the dog and But yeah, so to answer your question, I got to play with. I forget what the dog's real name was, but. Roxy. It was not Roxy, I don't think. No, it was something else. I know. I just crushed your world.
Okay.
That dog is such a diva.
It's okay, Roxy.
Stage names. Did he have his own trailer, too?
Probably,
yeah.
Definitely had his own treats.
Some spoiled little canine there.
Yeah.
And so we realized that... Well, there was a disconnect between Beth and Janice, too, on who, like, Janice was giving certain, like, her input, and then it turned out to not be the case.
Yeah, because this started as Janice's case.
Mm-hmm.
When Andrew was attacked in a restaurant.
Right.
I don't remember exactly what the time frame was, like how far in the past this was in the world of the show. But and that complaint and restraining order... my character handled. So when this came back, it was sort of like, oh, no brainer. It's Kenneth. He's up to his old tricks. And then Beth obviously takes over. But that's kind of what explains that scene at the end where Janice comes to her sort of...
apologetic.
Because, Janice is very good at her job and she likes being good at her job. And this one, she missed. And she takes a little hard.
Right. But it was interesting, though, because just when she went in to talk to Beth about it, she didn't even let... Janice, talk.
Nope.
Yeah. No, like, you can get you're sorry, you're wrong, bye.
But it was actually sweet because she was saying, like, if you're coming here to apologize, don't.
Right, yeah,
it's not necessary. Was nice, go home. You're
fine. She said, we had a good day.
Yeah, she was letting me off the hook of, beating myself up. But but anyway, it was in Beth's way. It was Beth being sweet.
Yeah, Beth keeping it real, as we say.
Hashtag Beth gets real.
She always gets real,
Hashtag Beth gets
real. So we find out that, in fact, it is. I keep wanting to call her Amanda. Andrea. She's in my heart, her name is Amanda. Andrea decides that, or we realize that she's actually the one that was creating all of this to happen. She has like some type of something clicked
personality
in
her
personality disorder to where she was creating these situations and she was really like stalking herself.
I love that they put out just enough bait so you can find out kind of along with Jack. Whenever he figures out there's a connection between the art.
Right.
Because you're like, and then he's like, and then that's the way it goes. It's great.
Jack always finds that one clue, to that connector clue, I feel like.
He does.
Yeah, I actually we had some people on YouTube this week wondering whether or not we're going to start seeing Beth get a little bit more involved in some of the cases, because it seems like the past couple of episodes, Jack has been pretty instrumental in solving things. So that'll be interesting.
I feel like he had to prove his worth to Beth, so they focused on him a lot.
That's true.
And then I feel, well, this is the prediction. I'll save it.
Save the prediction for later, girl. Wow. Save it for later.
Anastasia.
So we find out that she's totally off her rocker. They go to the house do I go to Melissa first? Did they go to Melissa? Why did they try and get to Melissa?
Because she sent the video, remember?
Right, that's right. She sent the video, and they said, okay, here's a video of, like, your husband, your husband with his ex-wife.
Oh, wait, you forgot to address, though, when her husband was at the party. And remember, he attacked her in the kitchen room? So at that point, I kind of sealed the deal that it was Kenneth. Until they brought him in and they checked out his alibi.
Right. But there still felt like there's a missing piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We weren't really satisfied with that.
But when you did see him creep through the thing, remember when the scene first opened up, I was like, it's him.
They really did set him up as a stalker.
I mean, generally speaking, I mean, we had a couple episodes ago, somebody who was suspected of stalking had rifles in their house. This guy, Kenneth, should probably not be creeping on people if he wants to not be considered a stalker. It's just a tip for people out there.
You should stop. A tip for future characters.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And I think that's something that, too, because when you see Andrea, she's getting ready. She's at her function, her fundraiser, one of her many fundraisers. And she's like, I'll be right back. And she goes upstairs to the kitchen, and she goes by herself. So you have this stalker on the loose. You're afraid for your life. Why are you going upstairs, like, alone? Right.
Because she's not.
Yeah, she was.
And that to me, now that I look back on it, you say, oh, okay, well, that explains why she went by herself. Because, you know, whenever you see in, like, movies or shows and something's going wrong in their lives and they go somewhere by themselves. Like, I'm going to have a buddy system with me, maybe a bodyguard if it's in my budget. You know, something to protect myself. But she's just going by herself. And there's security at the party. Like,
she was baiting him, I think.
She was.
Yeah.
And that's what made it even more interesting. You realize how sick she is in the head. Because then you get to when she's at the house and she's got Melissa tied up, poor little thing, and she's explaining to her master plan, and now she's been planning this all along because Melissa shows up to her doorstep all apologetic, like, I'm leaving him, you were right, it's like, get off my porch, okay, you were the mistress, like,
you
ruined my life.
Kind of bad, though, that we all, like, labeled Melissa as the crazy person, and she's the one coming to apologize? Yeah.
And also, Melissa didn't know, in her defense, that they were married.
So she said. Yeah,
that's what she came over to tell.
Oh, she
really loved him, and she didn't know that he was married.
Jade.
Okay.
You think she wanted a piece of the 95?
I'm just saying.
Okay.
I mean, she was young and naive. She probably believed whatever story he told her.
Yeah. Right.
Because remember in the beginning, and I think it was Beth that asked her, well, how do you know that's where he was? And she was like, because he told me. So she obviously just trusted whatever he would tell her.
Right.
So she probably really believed that he wasn't married.
I like that you're standing up for the mistress. I think that's great.
I've been
I can relate.
Actually, no, I cannot.
She didn't know.
Fine, okay, she didn't know. I believe you. I believe her. But so when she comes to her doorstep, just like boohooing and crying, and you're thinking, oh gosh, girl, get off that doorstep. If you do not get into your VW bug and drive off into the sunset, you are not safe. And
specifically the VW bug.
Well, you saw the bug in the back?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So she clocks her in the head with the gun, right? She lets her in the house, and she's like, boom, right on the back of her head.
It hurt.
That's the first time we saw Andrea's psychotic behavior, too, because she was like, yes, come in. And then you just saw the face change as soon as poor Melissa walked.
That door closed. It was over for Melissa.
Yeah. I think it was great. This is props to the makeup team, I think, and also the actress playing Andrea. But we see gradually throughout the episode, she's getting visibly a little bit crazier looking, too. You know what I mean?
I noticed that, too. Yeah, it's props to our makeup department. They're amazing.
Absolutely.
So great. And I thought that, too. I thought by the end, I'm like, wow, her eye looks sort of like tweaky. And it's just like, which is from the bruise, but it just actually added to her kind of... the mask of crazy kind of, you know, revealing itself.
Yeah, she started seeming a little darker, and it was really cool.
She played it so well.
She did.
Really, it was very believable, and to the point where I'm, like, thinking, okay, wait, is she really like this in real life?
Or, she's not.
I know she's not, but that's when a performance is so believable, when you start to actually associate it with, like, their personality, then you're like, okay, yeah, you really did a good job, because I was really convinced, like, this woman is off her rocker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it made it even more enjoyable when Melissa wakes up on the bathroom floor. She's like, about time you woke up. Like, we gotta get, we've got things to do.
Yeah. Like, I want you to be awake when this happens. Ouch. Jeez. God. Brutal. I want you to watch. Oh, God.
I know. And she's like, explain me. Just walk towards me and I'll shoot you in the head. It'll be over very soon. Yeah. I can't walk towards you.
No.
I'm
not going to happen.
Scared.
Knowingly walking into death. But Beth and Jack and company.
Mm-hmm.
Run in the dough.
Mm-hmm.
Always impeccable timing.
Always in the
nick of time.
Last week they busted through a wall. This week they're just coming in like classic style.
Think about
and they saved the day.
But you have to think about how unfun it would be if they got there like before, like 5 minutes before the nick of time.
Yeah. That would be lame.
Pretty lame. Like, dang, we missed a really good scene because
like had just knocked on the door.
Yeah, exactly. And then they show up.
Oh, okay, I won't.
We just spared you some grief. Yeah, trust us.
Exactly.
We can't forget about the conversation between Jack and Andrea.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
No, remind me.
So, I think Andrea's trying, or Jack's saying that, you know, men are weak and that's why they cheat.
Snap.
Go ahead.
No.
And I think, Beth was trying to egg Jack on, too, which was, like, the best part. Because she was like, tell him, Jack, why do men cheat?
Yes, and he's like, well, I wasn't thinking I was going to have to go this deep into it, but because we're insecure.
Jack gets put on the spot a lot.
He's like, Beth, I'll tell you later.
I know. Beth, I don't mind opening up to you, but, like, not in front of company.
Right. But it was nice to see him actually be honest, and I think, you know, Beth says later on it really works for you, so maybe we'll see more of that.
Yeah, I think... Actually, I could sense when she was egging him on, it was almost like she was starting to like him as a person a little more. You know?
I just saw it as her trying to break through to Andrea.
I didn't really see it as egging on. Yeah, it was like a tactic.
Because her facial expression more was like, she also looked a little bit alarmed. And so it was more like, tell him, like, even if he made up a lie, it just seemed like she wanted to break through to...
She saw that it stopped her and it got her attention. And then he stopped talking and it was kind of like, keep going.
Exactly.
Keep going.
So I guess, Cam, it's not what we thought.
There may have been an element of her own curiosity.
Oh, you're so kind. It's like,
I feel like
I saw that, you know?
What?
I don't know.
Beth is just way too professional and too, like, just, I don't know what the word is, but to, like, egg him on at that time, I think.
Yeah.
You know?
Right. She was focused on.
She's focused. She's all about the word.
Yeah, that's focused. And it worked, Andrea, of course, because she's crazy. So him admitting that he was weak, you know, he was broken, she wanted to, she's obviously a very dominant person, so right. she wanted him to admit, you guys are weak, you're this, you're that. I mean, I feel her.
But I love the way he went in and snatched that gun from her, like, okay, that's enough. Yeah. Enough of you, crazy lady.
Yeah.
We had an overwhelming sense of feeling bad for Melissa at the end of this case.
We did.
Because first we wrongly accused her of being a crazy person.
We weren't wrong. I mean,
she's wrong, but we accused her of being the stalker, and then she ends up in gunpoint, and now she's just going to be even more crazy and out of control.
Now it's two situations: the 5150 and this situation.
My God. So sorry, Melissa.
Hope no, things... sorry to her next boyfriend.
That is true.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's got a lot of baggage to deal with.
Or her husband's going to have some baggage to deal with. Your ex-wife held me at gunpoint and told me to walk towards her so she could. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She was saying things like, we're going to get, you're going to be dead. And then when he gets out of jail, I'm going to be there for him. We're going to get back together.
She thinks she can fix him.
Yes, she wanted to fix him. She's like, yeah. Men can be broken, men can be fixed.
Mm-mm.
No?
No.
But you're not broken.
Thank you. Thank you, Jay.
You're welcome, Jay.
Appreciate it.
Anytime.
Should we move on to some relationships?
We should, but first we should talk about how you can listen and view our episodes for the recaps that we do for Stalker.
Oh, yeah. Because
you can go to itunes.com/AfterBuzzTV and be so kind, give us not one, not two, five stars. Five?
12 stars.
12 stars.
If 12 is an option.
If 12 is available, on a scale of 1 to 5, if you can do 12, go on and do that. And you can also go to youtube.com/AfterBuzzTV and you can visit our
AfterBuzzTV app, iTunes podcast store. You can download it on your phone. It'll stalk your phone. Stalk your phone.
Stalking is very convenient when it comes to finding AfterBuzzTV.
It's true.
And if you're really lost, go to Google. You can do that too. But don't forget to comment and like and subscribe. But definitely comment. We love the comments that you guys sent us. It keeps us going and really inspired to keep the show going. So we really want to hear what you guys have to say. It means the world to us.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. So
now on to relationships.
We see Jack and Amanda talk some things out.
They had a smackdown this episode.
A literal smackdown.
Yes. And Amanda reveals what she has against Jack, whatever happened in New York. And I honestly thought it was going to be a little bit bigger. I mean, that is a really big deal. But for some reason, I thought it was going to... I don't know what I thought it would be. I just thought it was going to be bigger.
I was uninspired.
I didn't know it was going to be a cheating situation between them. I mean, I know it's linked to...
I thought it was going to be like you stalked my sister or something.
Like he murdered somebody.
Right, something like that.
Well, he slept with a
key witness. It is a big deal. But I thought it was, I don't know.
It wasn't as big.
I think the bigger issue for Amanda is that he denied being the father.
Yes.
For a few years.
And he was in and out of their lives for a long period of time.
And I think that's probably, you know, her issue with him more so than just the infidelity is probably his, because it seems more about Ethan than it does about whatever went down in their relationship between the two. It's very personal about, you know, you stay away from him, you're not a father to him, I think.
Right. And her reasons, I feel, are pretty valid of if you're denying your son, the child that you have together, and you don't want, you're in and out of the child's life, I can see why when someone comes as a mother wanting to be protective of her child, saying, I don't want my child to be old enough now to really know that this is his father who's in and out of his life, because the mother's left with the mess to have to deal with the kid having issues and being sad. And that, I could only imagine what kind of toll that would take.
Right. She's just trying to be protective there.
She's just being a good mother. And so she's in pure defensive mode. And I can see why she's not really buying it from him, because fool me once, but, you know, second time.
Well, and Jack's not helping his case either, because he's just like showing up at the house and peeking through the windows.
He's creeping.
Parking outside behind the car and protecting Ethan on Halloween and whatever.
Ethan recognizes him.
Yeah.
I like how like Ethan kind of did like a stalker move on him. When he looked, and he's like, wait, where'd he go? He's not at the car anymore. And at first, I'm thinking, don't tell me this kid gets kidnapped in this episode.
Oh, my God.
I'm not ready for that. He's too cute. But then it turns out he's, like, standing behind Jack, like, hey, you again. So that was a cute moment that they shared, and then it was interesting because then Trent, Amanda's boyfriend, comes is like, "Who? Don't talk to strangers." I wasn't talking to a stranger, and then you see Jack like running like for dear life.
Jack runs a lot.
Jack does run a lot.
Yeah, he's fit. He's in shape.
He's gotta get those workouts in.
Yeah.
Go Jack.
Go Jack.
That scene where she brings him in and slaps him though, that was great.
That was pretty aggressive.
I was pretty happy with that scene because she's like, "Hey, can I talk to you for a second, real quick? I'm just gonna borrow borrow Jack for a second." Takes him in. She's like, "Wait, get away from it."
And then after that, when Trent confronts Jack in the hallway, and it got awkward. That's the awkward turtle status.
Right, because he asks him, he's like, "Stay away," and he goes, "Wait, are you his dad?" So then you're thinking, what did Amanda not tell her boyfriend? Because obviously, to him, something's not adding up for him to be wanting to see her son. You know, I think he kind of sensed, wait a minute, if this guy wants to see the kid all the time, something she told him is not adding up, which I think is going... I'm getting into predictions, but it could push somebody away because you're not giving him all this information and he's practically helping you raise your kid for you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
And he puts Jack on the spot. He says, "Tell me, you know, is Ethan your child?"
Right. And he's like,
he wants to know what he's getting into.
But he doesn't
answer
him.
And what does he do? He runs again.
He runs.
Always running, Jack.
Well, it seems like Trent really wants to be in... Amanda's and her son's life even more because he said, "I need to know what I'm getting into." So it sounds like he's thinking long term, maybe. I mean, he's obviously a father figure already to Ethan, just being at the house all the time. Mm-hmm. So that is going to go further, I mean, think.
Yeah, because you see that Amanda really obviously wanted to start like a new life for herself. And I'm pretty sure Jack in the picture is not really helping her, her cause.
Yeah, true that.
Yeah.
True that. What about Beth or Jack and Janice in this episode? Jack and Janice.
I thought Janice was... I'm sorry, really. I thought you were going to be spying on that conversation like you were spying last week on the other conversation. Right. So I was like, where's Janice? She's listening somewhere.
Know?
Janice knows a lot more than she lets on, I think.
Janice does.
Not a lot gets past Janice.
Mm-hmm. No.
No.
And it was interesting, like, in the last episode when she shows up and he's like, "Hey, no, like, we're not going to do it." And she's like, "No, you need a friend."
Exactly.
Yeah. You're just lonely and I have beer to be a friend to you.
I love that so much because I was so afraid that it was going to turn into, like, the desperate girl, like, you know, office crush. And it's so not. And the writer's like, no. Like, they hooked up. They're both like, "Yeah, let's do this." I mean, I obviously I'm biased, but I love Janice. And I love to think of her as like a cat. She's just so curious. And she's just like, "What's this? What's going on over here?" You know, how cats do.
Right.
And she's fascinated by people. She's fascinated by Jack. He's hot. She was like, "Yeah, let's party." And then she kind of saw with that interaction that she was spying on, this guy's a mess. Like, she knows. Janice knows. She's like, "This is a mess, and I thought this was kind of, like, fun and exciting, but I really don't want that."
Right.
"But let's just have fun as a friend." So the sort of rapport that they're establishing in the office is sort of, you'll see it more and more, which is, like, flirty, but it's not, it's
desperate.
At least...
I like that.
Not at all. Like, I know.
That's what I thought, too, when I, at
not
first,
at all.
I was like, uh-oh, Janice is going to be desperate now.
No,
but
she's not.
You're right.
I like just that like Janice gets to, like, switch gears a lot. And
yeah.
She can adapt to the situation.
I get to switch, which is a lot of fun to play. But, yeah, no, I think they have fun with each other. I think they're friends.
Mm-hmm.
And they flirt, and that's kind of their rapport. That's how they sort of, their inside jokes with each other.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the writers could write a new episode and you know,
and
eradicate everything that they're saying right now. But I don't think Janice is holding any sort of candle. I think she cares about him.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they're buddies at this point.
I think she's playing it. I feel like her character is playing it smart.
She's a smart girl.
Right, like, let me go on the friendship route versus the dating
she's
route.
She's like the date. Well, she knows. I mean, she just wanted a hookup. Like, she was like, "This guy's hot.
Mm-hmm.
Let's have fun."
Without giving too much away, is that going to happen again?
How she?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
Not that I know of.
Interesting. Interesting. I did definitely see in this episode, though, more of the cat play around, flirty type of thing you were talking about.
Yeah.
Which was really nice. Because, like we said, otherwise your character would have been painted a completely different way,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, yeah. She's not... She's much more male, too. Like, there's... Mm-hmm. I love that she's, like, the perfect mix of feminine and masculine. And that's kind of how she approached this, the whole Jack situation. It's more like a guy. Yeah. It was
with
like
the beers.
Like,
I caught that.
Yeah, like, dude, it was cool, but let's not. But let's hang. But, but yet I still get to be a woman, very much so, right. Dress like a woman and wear makeup and not be like the tough girl on the cast, which that just is so boring to me.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of times in the procedural shows, like the tough chick is so one note, you know, that you don't get to be complex like people are.
And I think that's good because just as being a woman watching other women on TV, it gives a better impression or influence, you know, versus seeing the girl that goes head over heels and loses her mind over this guy, and she's super desperate and anxious, and it's like melodramatic, and you're just like, oh, here we go again.
And it's affecting her work.
Right. Where this, you see a woman that says, okay, wait, I'm going to be smart.
Yeah.
And I feel that, because when you watch TV, you have to admit sometimes things you see in the media, sometimes you do allow it to reflect on what you, your aspiration.
Of course.
Sure. Becomes very aspirational for you. So it's cool to see like these tough women that are still in like blouses and girly and heels and
our nails done, lipstick,
hair is did, everything looks like, you know, and that's relatable. But then personality wise you see like this toughness, but it's not like forced. It feels very realistic and relatable.
Oh good.
So that's like a really good thing that I like. We always say that, like, we always find like realistic situations
that
come out from the stories,
because we always talk about every week how people actually have complained online and complained, tweet, whatever, about there being not very strong women characters in the show, which I completely disagree
with. Yeah, we all three of the main characters are strong female characters.
And that was the thing, is that people were saying, oh, it puts women in a bad light because it shows them as being weak. But then what we noticed was that you're seeing women fighting back.
Yeah,
like the women that are being attacked by these perps, like, they're fighting back, they're standing up for themselves, they're speaking up, they're letting, notifying the police. You know, even the last episode when the girl had like the boyfriend and she
finally stood up to him at the end.
Yeah,
you know,
that's what you want. That's, you don't want to see her take him back and feel like, dang, there's just no hope in this world. You know, and
all right, I guess.
Yeah, you know, so that's the thing. Like, we always bring that up a lot when we discuss the show, is how wrong whoever opinions those were. I mean, you're allowed to have opinions, but obviously their opinions were wrong. And we notice that we see it to be quite different, which is something that we enjoy, because, you know, when you're doing a show and if you're not like, you know, if you have shows you get assigned, sometimes they're great, good shows and you have a lot of fun with, and some shows you're like, oh, okay, it's good.
Well, thank you. I like the female characters on this show, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Why don't we move on to Ben and Jack's relationship? We really saw it a little bit, but I have to tell...
Yeah, I need to know what your beef is with Ben.
Okay,
what's
so...
the Ben
beef?
He's
got a theory.
A couple episodes ago, we see Perry, of Perry Whitley,
of
the Whitley family. We see him on the phone being informed. There's some informant. So my probably ridiculous prediction is that Ben is the guy feeding him information.
He is a big research guy.
Mm-hmm. I thought you were just about to say he is. I was like, what do I got?
Oh my gosh.
I'm just...
I saw your face, Cameron.
Yeah, I know. You're like I would let that information just fly out of my mouth.
Right.
So, that's an interesting theory.
Yeah. It's probably super outlandish, but I have had a pattern of just predicting the most innocent people of being the ones who were doing the crimes. Like,
I like your thinking, though. You're thinking, you're dissecting. Yeah. I thought you didn't like Ben.
I don't.
You don't.
Because he's informing Perry.
Okay.
But that's why I don't like him.
Okay.
I like
him.
Know that.
If he's not informing Perry,
that's your theory.
He's great. Right. That is, it's a theory, yeah.
But even with Ben and Jack, I liked his I like Jack's attempt to win Ben over. It's like if it's the last thing he does. Yeah, so this time he burned him a CD because they were talking about music earlier and we all saw
those
that.
Those two are more romantic than Jack and Janet.
Yes, they are.
At this point. Like, they're really, like, they're courting.
It's a bromance in the making.
I tell you, it just wait. There's some bromancing.
Yeah. A lot of effort on Jack's part to get
a
to
lot.
This point.
It's very one-sided at this point.
Without really knowing Jack's too much of his backstory, I feel like you can always see Jack trying. Like, it looks like he's always trying to have a relationship, like, with Beth or with Ben. You just see him putting in a lot of effort into his relationship.
Right, I think his goal is to really fix himself. That's why he came to L.A. He
redemption.
Wants to start clean.
So, you know, even though we don't know exactly, you know, what he was like in New York or, you know, how he was sleeping with this witness, it's like, you can, he does such a good job of showing this character that had some type of rough past and that he's trying. Because I just see him in every relationship trying to make an effort. Even with when Trent confronted him, he told him, hey, I'm not going to be a problem for you.
Mm-hmm.
So
I mean, he could have easily said, yes, Ethan is my son. And then that would disrupt the relationship between Amanda and Trent.
Right. I feel like I'm waiting for, in the beginning, I was waiting for Jack to go off because we kept thinking, oh, he's stalking his son. Look at the pictures on the wall. Like, when is he going to go off? When is he going to get caught for stalking his son? But it's like he's kind of soft. He's kind of mellow.
Yeah. Totally.
And he's making progress. His relationships are getting better, as we've
they
seen
are.
In this episode.
Surprisingly, no coffee moments in this episode. There's been a correlation with coffee and awkward moments in the past couple of episodes.
Well, you know, pour a cup of coffee, there's...
Stuff happens.
Stuff happens.
The more
Steven.
You know.
That didn't happen.
Oh, okay. Aw, you weren't feeling it at this time. All right, well, let's get into a little bit of news and gossip.
AfterBuzz TV News.
I think I have a few comments to read.
Okay.
From last week.
Go crazy.
We have Joseph Boza said last week that if you're a fan of Kevin Williams in Silent Production, it's obvious because he wrote the episode last week. And he said, for some reason, on a scale of 1 to 10, the scare factor was only at a 6 for him.
Not for
I disagree
us.
With you,
an 11.
I'm going to have to disagree with him completely.
Yeah. Holy crap.
We were asked to keep it down. We were screaming so loud when we were screening the show last week.
There were just so many of those.
Yes.
So many jumps.
Yeah.
I'd also like to point out that Joseph, I would like to selfishly point out that Joseph also said he thinks Perry might have an informant on the inside, but it'll be a person we least expect.
That's why you wanted to read that comment.
Maybe. That might be true.
I'm on to you, Cam.
We have another one from Captain Marvel. Sorry on the pronunciation. He said, my guess is when Michelle struggled, Michelle being Beth, we found out her real name last week, struggled to defend herself, her stalker in the house, she accidentally set it on fire. Because we found out last week that Beth had a family die.
Oh, yes.
That was actually my prediction, was that she was stuck in the fire, or her family was stuck in the fire, and she was the only one that got out.
Right, and did you predict last week that, I think you might have that the fire was happening at the same time, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Teresa's pretty, she's been the most accurate,
Teresa,
I think, in terms of predictions.
Teresa, I'm on to you. You've got to inside connect
animal.
That stalker. Somebody's leaking you insider
you said
information.
She was the only one that got out?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Or the stalker saved her.
Sarah 4HP said that she loved the scene of Jack protecting his son during the Halloween episode last week. We always were a big fan of that, so thank you, Sarah, for the comment. And Lady J, is it just me, or is Jack making Beth look really incompetent? What do you guys think?
I don't think he's trying to make her look incompetent.
I think he's
trying.
I think he's just showing that he's capable of doing his job, and that maybe she can let go a little bit of certain things.
Yeah, right. I think it's like we said a few minutes ago, it's him trying to prove himself to validate being on the force and all that.
And we didn't talk about that last scene between Beth and Jack. Was that what you're going to get into?
No, I was going to say that's why Beth hired Jack. Why anyone hires anyone? She's the boss. I mean, he should be doing most of the groundwork.
Well, she didn't really want to hire him, as we found out. She didn't want to hire him, but at least we are seeing that he's earning his keep and proving to her that he deserved the job. I think.
And you finally got the validation that he wanted, Beth's acknowledgement that he is doing a good job.
And they have different skill sets.
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm.
Another comment, last one, holistic health and living. Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. They say Ben needs to grow the F up.
And they didn't just put the letter F in that comment, we're not going to say it because we can't curse.
I abbreviated. But we see, a little mixtape action.
Right, because last week they were very testy with each other, weren't they?
Right.
You're right.
Yeah.
Got it.
And I think that's all the comments we have for you guys. We found out last week, Teresa, do we have an update on the possible relationship between...
Oh, yeah. Between Dylan McDermott
and Maggie?
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Well, he is not married anymore.
Right.
Yes.
So...
Anastasia, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I don't have an update. I'll have to get back to you next week.
After a little stalking.
Unless,
I figured. No, it's okay.
I never comment on anyone's personal life.
She's like, my name's Bennett and I'm not in it.
Not on any show I've been on. I'm always like, mom's the word.
That's a good policy.
And that's how it should be.
Yeah. I have one tidbit. Tonight's episode is written by Dwayne Darian Jones, who also writes for The Following.
Which
is the show that you used to do for AfterBuzz.
The Following,
By Kevin Williamson.
Yep. Yeah. And we've been seeing a lot of people from The Following on the show. Warren Cole, who plays Trent, was a character on The Following.
Trent.
That is a good fact. Now, I've got a question for you.
Yes.
When your character, how do you get it? Do you research? What kind of research do you do to, play your character? Or do you do any at all?
Well, now that we're kind of into it, the research is sort of on-the-job research.
Yeah.
Right. The research is sort of doing it.
Right, right.
Because we've just been so busy filming. But initially... I did a lot of research, kind of more about what Janice is an expert on, which is the psychological background of people that stalk, because there is, unfortunately, but the reality is there's a real connection between mental illness and what drives people to stalk, and so I kind of did just some sort of cursory research on that stuff and looked up, one of the sort of the main disorders. And the guy who runs TMU, which is the real division here in LA, he kind of stops by. He's been kind of like our go-to consultant.
Oh,
and so
wow.
He stops by. He, I think, had more like one-on-one sort of sit-downs with Maggie and Dylan, but he's come by, and that's really fascinating. Because for me, it's more so... like the little things, because I like to focus on just sort of nerdy actor behavior things, and just to get specific about would you have your badge on right now?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Just like stuff like that. Like, when do you do that? Do you guys really talk about it right here? Like, would you go back to the office? Would you just go there? That's the kind of stuff that fascinates me. It's like learning the sort of boring everyday stuff.
But
as an actor,
important.
That makes it like real.
All the little details.
All the little details.
Because if you're a cop watching and you say, why are they holding their badge like that?
Right. Which, then cut to the guys, of course, never want to get rid of their gun. The girls always want to get rid of their gun because it hurts our hips. So. The reality kind of goes out the window sometimes when, the boys always want to have their gun. You watch. They'll always have their gun.
Right.
I never have it unless I'm out of the office.
We're going to start watching now.
Making tallies.
Now, I know.
Do you, I hope the answer to this is no, but do you have any... No. Okay, perfect.
Right, next question.
Have you ever been affected by any kind of stalking in real life?
Not to my knowledge,
not to
no.
Knowledge.
If they were stalking, they didn't let themselves be known. No. A dear friend of mine did, though.
Yeah.
So... It's real. It's real and it's out there. But no, I have not.
I mean, you're obviously close to that type of topic a lot now from working on the show. What kind of things do you take away from that? What kind of things have you learned about stalking in general?
It's the tips that we try to point out in the episodes. a lot of like the social media stuff. Like you don't, you know, don't say where you are. Where I feel like youngsters these days, it's like second nature to do that.
Right.
But that's just really not a good idea. And I, you know, I'll catch myself wanting to do that sometimes. And like I try not to. I always try to say where I was, not where I am.
Right. Or after you leave.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Just because it's, you know, you're just making yourself too available to people. Or you know, online dating. There's just thing, you know, you should not let people take you home so that they know where you live until you really know them. You know, there's just things like that. The parking lots are just being aware of.
Mm-hmm. We've learned a lot about parking lots.
Yes.
A lot about parking lots. Anytime you're alone.
It's midnight.
I'm going to start wearing, like, rear view mirrors on my head just to be like, what's going on?
Yeah, yeah. But just, you know, I think awareness, just heightened awareness. And, you know, certainly we don't want to make people paranoid, but I think being aware is always a good lesson to take away.
Yeah, and like we were saying earlier, I mean, something that's kind of cool is just encouraging people to report something whenever
absolutely.
They do experience
that it. That's a line that we always have.
Yeah.
Why didn't you report this?
Right.
But you're right. I think people don't until it escalates into something that's really, you know, really dangerous.
Yeah.
Because they think, oh, it's just, I don't know, maybe it's a mistake, maybe it's a coincidence, maybe I'm crazy, maybe I'm just imagining it, but...
Yeah.
Especially with relationships, too. That girl didn't want to tell on her boyfriend last week because she felt guilty. She didn't want to have that reputation. Mm-hmm. So, it's really important.
Yeah,
yeah.
Absolutely. Mariana, a lot of people know you from True Blood.
Yes.
And you, that show recently ended, and you transitioned over to this show. What is that like going from HBO over to a show like Stalker on CBS? What was that... Also... What was it like switching characters like that?
Yeah, well, there were some shows in between there, too.
You did, Devious Maids.
Yeah,
Devious Maids.
Yeah, and I don't think that that's hard at all.
Yeah?
I don't know. Maybe that's just me, but, I mean, that's kind of what we do.
Like, yeah.
I love playing different characters. I love playing dramatically different characters.
Yeah.
I mean, I adored Lorena. I thought, I know a lot of the fans did not. Because she was a villain. I loved playing that character. I loved how messed up. She was just so beautifully broken to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, to me, I just thought that she was this, like, the most flawed girl, sad girl.
Mm-hmm. And there's that defining scene with the 180-degree turn.
Yeah.
I'm sure you hear a lot of.
Always, yeah.
You got an award from that, right? From Spike TV?
I did, yes. I have that award at home.
It was like craziest, like, what in the world scene?
The holy shit scene of the year.
Yes. Yes.
So awesome.
It deserved to win.
Yeah, yes. For sure.
But I guess have an interesting answer for that. I love doing that. I love going from something over here to transitioning to something way over here. It's always my fear to sort of get stuck doing the same type of character over and over and over again.
Now, you mentioned what attracted you to the character that you played in True Blood. What attracted you to your character, Janice?
It was actually her humor. Which, in a few episodes, I'm sad to say, has gotten cut out. In the pilot episode, there was a bunch of jokes.
A lot more, yeah, I would agree.
And it all got cut, because when the episodes run long, which they all often do, and you have to cut something down, that's usually not necessary to the case.
Mm.
It's great to have in there, but it's not absolutely necessary. It doesn't further the, you know, the storyline. So... like a lot of the jokes from the Halloween episode got cut. Mm. Yeah, so I watched. I'm like, But my jokes in this episode all got to stay, I think. So
how is that? Like watching? I know you said like usually you watch the first time, you pay more attention to yourself, like just to see like. You know, as an artist, like to see what you can do differently and better. But then the second time around, you really like to you pay more attention to the storyline.
Yeah, I mean, I try to take a just sort of more just objective audience view of it, as opposed to it's more so taking my ego out of it and not going, oh God, why did I do that? Why did they pick that take? I hate it. But yeah, so it's, you know, it gets easier to watch yourself over the years, but It's always a process.
With Stalker, are there ever any like alternate scenes, and you think, oh, they use that one and not the other one, or the ending, it ends differently?
Sometimes, I mean, it's really, you know, TV and film. It really, as opposed to theater, it's it's in the hands of the editor. I mean, it really turns into the director and the editor's story at the end of the day. Like you you give various takes, and then you kind of have to just throw your hands up, and it's it's hard because you see, like I said, you'll see a take that, because I am a freak and I remember my takes, and especially in TV we don't get very many because we have to move so fast.
Right.
So it's, you know, usually like two or three and then that's it. And so I remember them, and it kills me when it's one that I'm like, oh, no, I knew that. Oh, there was another one that was so much better. At least in my mind it was. But so that's hard, and you kind of have to, it's a lesson in letting go.
Right.
You have to just, you know, trust. And the thing I have noticed with television shows, the audiences, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but they seem to be more forgiving. As opposed to like a film where this is your only introduction to these characters and the only time you're going to really live with them. Whereas in TV, it's I feel like once you know the characters, you kind of just give in to this world and they're the characters. And that's not going to change. You're not going to be like, they sucked in that scene. It's just going to be like, oh, Janice is in the office right now.
Yeah.
Okay, that was an office scene. You know what I mean?
Like, we buy that.
Somehow the judgment dial kind of gets turned down.
And we talked about that, about Jack's character, how he was doing a lot of stalking in the first few episodes, but we were very forgiving and we didn't really judge him on that because we were like, well, it's his son.
Right.
One thing is because, you're hoping that this is a show that lasts a long time and you want to have a relationship with these characters, so I think that makes sense why you would.
Point.
But so that I sort of pacify myself a bit when I see something that I don't like, or when I think, oh, I really didn't, you know, I just was crap in that scene. I think, oh, hopefully they'll forgive me.
Fear is obviously a very prominent theme in this show. We talked a lot about our worst fears. One of mine is being attacked in the bathroom, like. We saw a couple episodes ago. I got terrified of somebody pulling the shower curtain back
episode.
And then being there. Yeah, the phobia episode. What is one of your fears, I guess? What is one of your worst fears like that?
You know what? When I saw Gravity and the scene where, spoiler alert, everybody's seen Gravity, right?
Yes.
Okay, where George Clooney, like, just... let's go and like floats away. I was so horrified, and I didn't realize that about myself, but watching that, and I watched an IMAX 3D.
Right. Oh no.
I thought, I think I would rather be eaten by lions than die like that. Like that, just sort of being floating in nothingness completely alone, that freaked me out.
So your fear would be dying in space.
Dying in space.
Okay.
That's a really good answer. I feel like that's
good
better.
That's very likely
that's
not.
That's way better than dying, fear of dying in the bathroom.
In space. Right.
Or snakes. Mine was snakes.
Snakes.
Clowns.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, clowns. I mean, I'm scared of all that stuff. Don't get me wrong.
No, but yours. I think yours wins though, because I think about it. I don't think like someone can say, "Oh, clowns don't really scare me," but I think anyone can agree. Yeah, I would hate to be alone in space and. Float off into oblivion and like
fall
and die.
That is literally
because you don't know like how long do you have out there,
and there's not even another creature.
No one's gonna find you.
No,
you don't know how long you'll be floating either.
No.
There's not even oxygen. Like it's just you're that's just
and what
just
happens?
Horrible
do you just stay floating once?
Your head explodes because you run out of oxygen.
You run out of oxygen, you die. But then your body just keeps floating around.
Yeah, so you'd just be like basically like no head, just floating. Not to be graphic or anything, but yeah, that's a really legitimate fear.
Jade gets real.
I'm just saying.
Whoa. It's so true, though.
Thanks, Cam.
It's so true. It's terrifying. That's, the solitude. I think that takes a cake. That definitely takes a cake.
Right.
We actually had a real quick viewer question. They wanted to know, it was Chrissy Connors on Twitter. They want to know, is there anyone you want to appear on Stalker with you as a guest star?
Oh, good one.
Oh, that is a good one. I feel like it would be a laundry list of people. I'm going to pick out one of my dearest friends since we were talking about True Blood.
Sure.
How about Kristen Bauer of Ann Stratton, who played Pam on True Blood?
Oh,
wouldn't
I love
that be fun?
Pam.
Good answer.
Good answer.
And another strong female character.
Another strong female character.
And let's get into some predictions real quick because it's about that time.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
Predictions. Jade, you didn't do the prediction dance.
Oh.
Thank you. Okay.
So, running short on time, so it's a quick dance. All right, Teresa, what's your prediction?
Well, I think that... very last scene with Amanda and Jack, I was surprised that she kind of gave in a little bit. I thought she was going to be firm and say no, mm-hmm. but it wasn't a definitive no to me. So mm-hmm. I think she kind of left the door open, and he has a chance of really being able to stay here. So I think we're going to see more of that next week. And Trent and Jack, that'll be interesting how that plays out. I think Jack, you know, like, handled it pretty well and didn't really throw him under the bus. Mm-hmm. So we'll see how that goes. I feel like Jack's really fixing his relationships in this episode, and he's being honest with himself, and I think that's going to pay off.
Anastasia, prediction?
Okay, I predict that Beth is going to open up to mm-hmm. Jack eventually a little bit about her, since we saw that end scene. I predict that Amanda is going to come around, like Teresa said. And I predict by the end of this season that Ethan and Jack will get to know each other through Amanda, that's going to happen. She'll let it happen.
Cam?
Oh, I predict that Ben is still the informant.
You're sticking to your same prediction?
Oh, yeah, that's going to be to the end. I predict that next week we'll see Perry come back. Perry Whitley of the Whitleys.
The Whitleys, yeah.
What was the other one I had? I predict that we're going to find out. You remember when they called... or when Beth called the psychiatric hospital,
yes. mm-hmm.
and she asked if that patient had had a visitor, and then the person paused and said no. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to find out more about that next week.
Mm.
Yeah.
And I'm going to go with the prediction that Amanda is still hot for Jack.
Whoa.
The way she looked at him when he walked away, it just looked like all types of memories were coming back for her. She is holding on to some hope that maybe he really is coming around.
And that he's a changed man.
Yeah, and then like, bye-bye, Trent. Mm. So that's what my prediction is. Do you have any predictions? Or give us a little storyline, a little tease, a little something.
I predict that Janice somehow takes over the world.
You almost had us there.
I did.
It's probably more believable than Ben being the informant.
Yeah, probably.
You know, there's nothing that disproves that yet, I will say.
It's true.
Well, if we want to find you on Twitter or, like, Instagram, like, what's the best way for us to find you?
At Mariana Clavino. Mm-hmm. MARIANAKLAVENO. Twitter, Instagram, Hussay.
Awesome.
I'm there.
You can find me at Real Jade's World on Twitter.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at TheOnlyCamShaft.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram, new one, Stay Classy Anna.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Teresa Jane.
And that's it for us tonight. Thanks for watching.
Thanks so much for joining
us. Thank you.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.